Okay, so now we'll kind of talk about a piece by English designer Jonathan Barnbrook, and it kind of mocks the media overload that seems to accompany the Olympic Games. So if you've ever watched the Olympics, you can see that like a ton of money is sunk into advertising. Everybody's wearing a logo. All of the suits that all of the athletes wear are, covered in logos and advertisements. There's just a lot of money sunk into the Olympics every year with advertising dollars. And so this piece done by Jonathan is a series of pictograms called Olympukes. And he made this for the 2010 Winter Olympic Games. And it's kind of got some humor mixed into it. And it's called Drowning in Advertising. And it was a free wallpaper available for iPhones. So free download for your iPhone. Let me make this larger. Which is an interesting concept, really, to create these. So this is Drowning in Advertising from the set of pictograms that he created, which are called the Olympukes set. And actually, it was done in, I guess, 2009 for the 2010 Olympics. And this was done by Jonathan, but he actually works for Virus Fonts, and he's an English designer. And you can see that this kind of figure is drowning in this deep red wavy lines, which is kind of definitely borrowed from the logo of the famous brand of soft drinks, which we all know as Coca-Cola. And it's also using the same colors from the logo. And we can see that this consumer is calling for help, reaching his hand out or her hand out. And it really symbolizes the consumer drowning in advertising or maybe even in Coca-Cola. Because they're a huge presence at the Olympics, aren't they? So this was a, as I said, an iPhone wallpaper that was available for free download at that time. And here's a few more examples of some of the Olympukes that they made. So merchandise, he's got a piece of dew on his shirt here. Bribeable judge, sweatshops, sportswear, Olympic debt. So those are some of the other icons that were made, or pictographs that were made. So we'll talk about some other things here, book covers specifically. They function a lot like a corporate logo might. They kind of unite image and text to extend the message of a book and condense it into one memorable image that shoppers will see online or in bookstores. Book cover design is definitely a specialized field and has not gone out of style, even with the rise of digital books. So we'll take a look at Janet Hansen's cover for Voices in the Night. It suggests a turned down bed sheet, and the curving black and white lines also recall lines on type, as pages that we might turn when we read our books, our actual physical book. So even digital reading devices simulate the turning of paper pages, so it's kind of an interesting design element to weave into a book cover design. And this was done in 2014. So definitely a very simple color scheme. Very simple concept, but it works really well. So we're actually going to kind of get into less of traditional print media and more into kind of motion graphics and the design of motion graphics. So logos, posters, and book covers are printed objects that are usually still or static, but there is a growing design field called motion graphics, in which a designer uses visual effects, live animation, action to create two-dimensional product or project that actually moves. Designers combine these techniques in various ways for time-based sequences that can be used on either websites, television, opening sequences of movies, and/or music videos. So there's a lot of different areas that you can use these in. So motion graphics kind of began with the discipline for making title sequences for Hollywood movies. So the roll of credits at the beginning of the movie used to be a huge thing. It used to be 5 minutes of just credits at the roll of every movie, at the beginning of every movie. Back in the day, I feel like title sequences are kind of gone out of style, and actually the beginning of the movie usually will just start right away, and then at the end they have the titles. But it used to be actually the other way around traditionally, especially in traditional Hollywood movies. Most title sequences at the time in the 50s and 60s were merely so like really slow scrolls of names, until the arrival of Saul Bass in the early 1960s. And Bass kind of had a different view. He thought that the title sequence was kind of an opportunity to create a climate for the story that is to follow, because the audience involvement in the film should begin with the first frame, is what he thought. And so that was kind of a different thought that Saul Bass had, because before that, like I said, probably since the advent of film, that it had just been slow moving words for the title sequences. So with the arrival of advanced digital editing, oh, we'll take a look at this actually really quickly. One of his animated movie sequences from, oh, darn it. Let's see here. Maybe we'll just do this. Since my YouTube link is no longer. So this is the title sequence that kind of, that Saul Bass designed and really kind of broke a lot of with a lot of the tradition of not having any kind of animation at the beginning. So we'll kind of scrub ahead here, but so he's incorporating image, to create the title. And so this is a really early example of this, but this was, like I said, he's really breaking a lot of new ground here with this. So, and this is all done analog. They didn't have any digital technology at this point, so I don't think they were able to use much of for computers. This was all done with film techniques. But anyways, you get a slight idea of what I'm talking about with that. Some early title sequence there. So, the arrival of advanced digital editing in the 1990s ensured the takeoff of motion graphics. So the computer comes into play, and this really enables designer to create each frame of a sequence with all the freedom that photo editing allows. So motion graphic designers are basically directors of short but intense projects that combine input from many sources. So the most original use of the new technology definitely came with Kyle Cooper's work on the title sequence for the movie Seven, which was kind of a dramatic crime story. And this is the still from 1995 film directed by David Fishner, and this was done by Kyle Cooper. It's the title sequence for the movie Seven. I do believe I have a video of this as well. Hopefully this still works. We'll see how it goes. We're not going to watch the whole thing, but I just want to show you. This was like kind of an early example of motion graphics done for the title sequence of a movie from 1997, I believe, or 95. So the title sequence really has a plot of its own. This man with bandaged fingers assembles and stitches together a booklet about murder and sexual deviance. And it's got layered images of film clips and spoiled type, and it's kind of a nervously twitching across the screen, along with the hand-lettered credits. And the soundtrack was done by the band Nine Inch Nails, so it kind of goes along with the deviant nature of the movie. And there's a haunting close-up sequence that has a function in the actual script. It kind of introduces the audience to the mind of the killer, who actually doesn't even appear until 40 minutes into the film. So, this is actually being used to kind of introduce this killer's mind to the audience right off the bat, basically, which is an interesting use of the title sequence, really. Although title sequences are a digital medium, motion graphic designers still crave that hand-drawn look. So Karen Fong, she creates a lot of fast-moving, revealing sequences, and she actually did this for the television series Rubicon. And she actually was nominated for an Emmy with this. And it's basically she did this. This is a series of different stills from her opening sequence for this actual, I believe it's a television show. Television series. So this is the opening credits for that, done by Karen. And it's basically, the series is about a main character that investigates a suspicious death. And he kind of begins to uncover a wide-ranging conspiracy. And the title sequence kind of reflects that in how it's designed. The title sequence basically follows a hand-drawn yellow chalk line through lists of data, pages of computer printouts and barcodes, maps, different documents, photographs, and film clips all put together. And it kind of, definitely the design of that hints at the main character's search for clues in this various and the various kind of evidence that the main character ends up uncovering in this mysterious murder case. So it's kind of definitely harkening back to the storyline. And as I said, Fong's title sequence was nominated for an Emmy Award. And she also creates a lot of other motion graphics for various other media, including video games and advertisements. We could take a quick look at this. I'm not really going to talk about her other work, though. You're going to have to read the book to see her other, the artist spotlight on her, basically. But you can see how this is being put together. So, kind of an interesting way of doing that. We've already seen stuff like this, but at the time that this was made, this was kind of revolutionary way of doing it, and that's why she won an Emmy for it. So let's see. We're going to talk about the Infopeel next. Let me try and find this. Okay, so one project for the Lincoln Center. This is Karen Fong here. But one of her projects for the Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts in New York required kind of coining a new name. It's called an Infopeel, which is a template of moving shapes with spaces for the insertion of dates or upcoming events and photos of the performance of the performers that come to the Lincoln Center in New York. And this is actually an advertising display that is outside of the building. It's almost like a digital billboard, but they call it an Infopeel. And it's basically an outdoor motion graphics display on the outside of the Lincoln Center. And the goal was to create a design that attracted the attention of moving viewers, people walking down the street or in cars, while directing their eyes to the information. So pedestrians and motorists across this busy intersection can now inform themselves about the Lincoln Center programming without actually having to stop in, which is a nice thing for the Lincoln Center. So you can see it here, the Infopeel 2009 in New York at the Lincoln Center. So we'll talk about interactive design. Let me take a look and see how much time we have. We might have to talk about this in the next video.